Hey, welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here. We're live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake, also live out of St. Paul. Well, we're showing live out of St. Paul over SPNN. We're glad to have you here. And we have some interesting information today. We're going to talk a little bit about a federal abortion ruling, federal court ruling on abortion in Texas. That I think was interesting. And good news for women in that ruling. Also, we're going to talk about parental rights, the parental rights constitutional amendment, give an update on that, and some opposition that has come to the parental rights amendment by, believe it or not, medical doctors, or the political organization of medical doctors. Also, the U.S. House of Representatives had a hearing on international abductions through divorce-related cases. I'm just going to give you an update. I'll have to get some video on that. It just happened today, but there's some very, very interesting testimony that took place regarding family law and people who flee to other countries or countries of their origin and take their kids with them, leaving the other parent without their kids, and what the U.S. was doing in these cases. That was fascinating. Also, a story that was broke, that I understood to be broken on Bob Zick's show, Inside Insight, about the discipline in St. Paul schools, made it national on the O'Reilly show. And since O'Reilly made it national, some of the local news started covering the show, or the issue of about teachers being beaten up and what's going on in St. Paul Public Schools. And so, in my opinion, you know, Bob was telling the story first, and then O'Reilly picked it up, and then some of the local news stations covered it. So we'll see a small clip of that. But the teacher that was on these shows may ask some very good questions, but I know why he's not getting an answer. So we're going to discuss why he's not getting an answer and why it is the way it is. And I think you'll be surprised, and once you think about it, I think you'll agree with me that this is what's going on. So it ties in with the gender equity, the transgender issues going on in St. Paul Public Schools. And then if we have time after all of that, the big issue. I'm sorry, we will have time. Judge Pendleton of the 10th Judicial District is being disciplined. And we will discuss why he's being disciplined in some of the games that go on. And years ago, I was the only one that brought out the issue of the behavior of Judge Pendleton and talked about him. And I'm going to have to go look in my archives and find out what I said about him. But I knew that he wasn't living in the district. And I had information from his wife. And so that came out in this report by the, this order was on the by the Board on Judicial Standards hearing panel. Of course, we got Judge Toussaint, Diana Ward, and Patrick Sexton. So this is what the Board on Judicial Standards recommends his discipline, but Judge Pendleton can go and appeal that to a different three-judge panel, have a hearing on that. If he doesn't like what they come down with, then he can go to the Supreme Court, and whatever the Supreme Court then rules is final. But as it stands right now, he's looked like he's facing 6 months of suspension from judgeship. I don't remember if it's without pay or not, but there's just a process to go through here. If I were him, I would accept that because it just doesn't look good for him, and he needs to realize that he didn't follow the Constitution. But that's kind of going to be our main topic. And then if we have time, we're going to discuss an order that came out in the appellate court on Michelle McDonald, who ran for the Minnesota Supreme Court, where she was contesting the ruling of a district court judge on probable cause for her DUI arrest. And she lost that probable cause case, but all this was before the hearing, and the information on this report that the judges cite as factual information as to why there was probable cause came out in the hearing that these things weren't part of it. So the factual information in here wasn't actually the facts of the case. But that's the problem with the judiciary and them protecting their own and protecting a system. So if we get to that, we'll get to that, who knows, but I wanted to let you know it's worth reading, but the facts are wrong. So now we cannot change the problem we have with probable cause and the problem we have with bad behavior by police officers. So, yeah, interesting stuff. So that's going to be the show today. And the first thing here, it is a live call-in show on today's date, June 11th. So if you want to call in, call 651-747-3838 with your comments or questions. And if you don't want to call in, there's an email, speechlessmn@gmail.com. You can email me there for comments or suggestions. And if you want to watch past episodes, youtube.com/speechlessmn for all most of my past shows. So we got a few more from 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years to get up there. And I have to go through them so I can, you know, these things take time, like with Judge Pendleton. It takes years to go through. So, you know, I believe I was reporting on this 4 or 5 years ago issue, and that finally the board is doing something about it. All right, so to begin, federal court abortion ruling in Texas is a huge victory for poor life, and abortionists are enraged. You know what the issue was related? It was related to women's health. In other words, if you take your pet to a pet hospital, they have standards of how clean and the procedures and the cleanliness and bacteria-free whatever to make sure that the animal is safe and the surgeries are safe. You go to the dentist, you go to your doctor, there's laws regulating the cleanliness of the hospitals. Same for food preparation. And there's inspections that get done. Abortion clinics, Minnesota, no. All across the United States, some states have regulations for cleanliness. Most of them don't. My understanding. But in there's a federal, well, Texas passed a law, and the law required clinics to operate under the same standards as any other clinic offering outpatient procedures. It would ensure that clinics basically operate under hospital level standards. Now, such an invasive surgery as abortion is, you would think that, yeah, that's what we would do. But it isn't. And it wasn't in Texas until they passed a law, and then somebody challenged that law. And there was a case, Whole Woman's Health versus Lakey, that the medical requirement advances Texas' interest in safeguarding maternal health and protecting women from substandard abortion facilities and practice. And so somebody sued to saying, hey, that's too much, you know, that enters too much into the privacy of a woman. And it's just a backwards mindset that why not have good, clean medical facilities for abortions? And if you look at the Gosnell case, how dirty that was, and you hear all the former abortion doctors who became pro-life, talked about how they wouldn't even clean the instruments in between the surgeries. You know, I mean, and that still goes on today. You know, so anyway, a whole bunch of bad stuff taking place. So the court said, yeah, well, you know what? you have to have clean facilities and you have to follow proper medical practices to protect the lives and health of women if you're having an abortion. You know, just really, really common sense stuff, but, you know, people just, for some reason, they got to fight even that. Unbelievable. But that's just the mindset. Of course, not unfamiliar mindset of the St. Paul School Board. We'll get into that later. Objectivity, science, biology, physics, let's just throw those out the window. That's what's going on. Let's go by our feelings and our emotions. That's what we're going to use to make our decisions. All right. Parentalrights.org had an announcement that the American Medical... Now, Parentalrights.org is trying to pass a constitutional amendment that would ensure that parents have the right to raise their children in the education and upbringing of their choice. Their religious upbringing, their education upbringing, and which has been a right of parents for long, from the beginning, okay? Parents got to do that. But unless you were in a communist state or Nazi Germany or other place, they would take, similar places, they would take away that right for you to educate your kids in your philosophy, your religion, your beliefs. You have to go with what the state says. Well, in America, it was assumed that parents had the right to do this. And court case after court case has said so, but now there's an attempt over the last 20 years to take away that parental right. And court cases have come along and cited international treaties, international laws, and said, you know, the state has more authority than the parent, without defining what the parent is doing wrong. So parental rights is trying to push for parents having these rights and get it into their constitution that these rights are fundamental and they stick with the parents. Well, the American Medical Association came out Monday and voted to oppose religious or philosophical exemptions for childhood vaccinations in what its members hope will be a determinative blow against informed consent and a parent's right to protect the bodily integrity of their child. Two states already deny parents and children these rights under law. Neither Mississippi nor West Virginia allow for a religious or philosophical exemption by law. These states coincidentally both rank at the very bottom in both education, 43rd and 50th, and economic, 50th and 45th outcomes, but suddenly the MAA finds them cutting edge. Okay. A bill in California, Senate Bill 277, is being steamrolled through the legislature in a rush to outlaw parental conscience in that state as well, which is in part was fueled by the AMA's decision. We will have a bill presently in California at the state legislature to remove all medical exemptions. We're worried that weak AMA policy will affect the California state legislature. Okay, so the big thing here is the government doesn't always get it right, okay? And their science and what they do isn't always right. And as we found out over and over, and as science finds out over and over, things that we're doing today that we think are good aren't actually good. And so to have a parent object to something that they believe will be harmful to the children is right and normal and natural. And of course the words best interest or best standards comes out there. And the reality is there is no best standards because doctors are performing a practice. They don't know everything that's going on and they don't know all causes and effect. And there's some things that work better than others, but for you to, as a parent, to not have a say in what's going on with your child is a big, big deal. So to remove the right to have a say and to ask questions mean that you don't have those parental rights for the medical upbringing of your kids, and whatever the state says that is, it's what it's going to be. So it's important that you go and talk to your doctor to find out the effects of how this is going to affect your relationship with your doctor and what he's going to decide to do with your children if this comes to pass. And telling the doctor your best defense against a false medical abuse claim is a solid relationship with your child's doctor. I mean, that's your doctor's best defense, is you got a solid relationship. Otherwise, you can get them for malpractice if something goes wrong, because you're forced, they're forced to take the medical doctor's decision in that case. So, I mean, this just creates a whole lot of problems. Let's see on this issue. Here's what a representative from the Infectious Disease Society of America quoted as summing up. He said, the science has to trump some of the ethical personal freedoms. Okay. But, you know, they don't necessarily get the science right. All right, one's legal rights do not depend on science, a fact of constitutional and natural law the AMA seems to have missed. I mean, that's a big statement there. Legal rights do not depend on science. Of course, you have the global warming. This is the science of the day. It's irrefutable. And now it's climate change. Boy, but I remember when we were going to have global cooling. It was big. And then all of a sudden, the Mississippi River dried up. And, oh, we got global warming. You know, that's coming. And the next year, the Mississippi River flooded, you know, right here in this River City. You know? And so they don't know, but they're saying they know. And therefore, the whole purpose is to take away your liberties and freedom, and instead of living with how things actually are, you know, and protecting liberties. So you don't have to believe in climate change in order to have your liberties taken away, okay? You just don't need your liberties taken away because of climate change either, okay? It just doesn't have to happen. All right, you want to believe in climate change? Go ahead. Believe in it. Don't take away my liberties. Don't take away somebody else's liberties. Don't force them to pay for or do things that related around climate change that may or may not even happen. And plus, you couldn't even do enough to defend against it anyway. I mean, in the marketplace, the best way is the marketplace will decide that. And that's what we found works over and over in the United States. Okay. Things to watch out for, you know, already your parental rights are being taken away. Slowly, the public schools are, and let's get that DVD ready. We're going to show a clip from a news report on the St. Paul Public Schools. But it was brought out that there's this specific educational group, and Bob Zick played this on his show quite a bit and had been doing it for quite a while. And this group, what they're trying to do is they're based out of San Francisco, and Valeria Silva, the president, went down to San Francisco. What they tried and met with this group, and what the organization that tries to help public schools deal with achievement and disciplinary issues involving black students. So it's just a one race related organization. What about Hispanics, Somalis? You know, it's more about race. Than you know, why aren't the Somalis included in this? Also, you're dealing with, why aren't they dealing with Hmong? You know, it's just, they're just about one group. And so the St. Paul School District is, since 2010, spent about $3 million promoting, they sell the concept of victimization. And so there was an article by Steve Gunn, editor-in-chief of AEG News, that spills the beans on the story and how Pacific Educational Group is working with the St. Paul Public Schools and what they're advocating. And so St. Paul made some disciplinary changes. And what this meant is kids can abuse their teachers, can physically assault them, and there is no disciplinary steps. And Bob's been talking about this, and teachers have been calling in on his show saying, here's what's going on, for Bob Zick Insight. And finally, it hit the O'Reilly show, and then Channel 11 had a new story in response to that. So let's play that DVD now, and Channel 11's story, and then we'll make comments after that. But I want to listen to that teacher closely, because he makes some very important concepts, and I'll tell you why he's not getting anywhere after the video. All right, let's go.
For just behaving erratically.
Benner blames the district's racial equity policy. The policy was meant to close the achievement gap by eliminating institutional racism, but Benner believes it actually perpetuates it, and he blasted the district on the Bill O'Reilly show last week.
And I had an altercation with a student where the student actually punched me.
The district has seen suspension of black students drop significantly since the policy was adopted, but Benner says keeping disruptive kids in class only hurts them and their classmates.
They explain if a black student shouts out in class or a black student is disruptive, it's always explained as that's his or her culture. As a black male, I find that highly offensive.
The school district did not want to go on camera, but said in a statement, the district does not have race-based discipline rules, but rather strives for equity for all students in all ways. The St. Paul Federation of Teachers released a statement after Benner's appearance on Fox News saying, blaming students, blaming teachers, and blaming parents only continues a divisive argument that does not move us closer to building safe school environments where student discipline is not racially predictable. For his part, Benner says he's being targeted by the district for speaking out, but he's not backing down anytime soon.
My point is, let's ask everybody what behaviors will be acceptable and not acceptable in school.
The district says it does not condone or excuse poor behavior choices for any student. Meanwhile, Benner says the district has opened up 4 investigations into him and how he has handled discipline. A spokesperson for the district couldn't comment specifically on Benner, citing personnel issues, but did say he is expected to report back to the classroom in the fall. Randy and Julie.
Well, and his contention is those investigations were opened because he spoke out. Was it after he spoke out?
A little bit of both. Some are how he handled the situation, he says, and some he believes are because of retaliation.
All right. Thank you so much, mm-hmm. Bua.
All right. Here's a question he asked. Let's ask everybody what behaviors are acceptable or not acceptable. Okay. That question is a great question. What are the ground rules going on? What do we allow or don't we allow? That's the question that has to be answered. Now, I'm going to tell you why in a second, why that will never be answered. Okay. Now, a comment before that the St. Paul School Board, you know, or at least he was told, you know, this is acceptable. They in their culture. Well, whose culture are we promoting here? And here's the problem that comes into play. Because parents don't have a choice as to where they take their kids to school in a lot of places, they have to go to a public school. They can't afford a private school. They can't afford homeschooling. I mean, that costs money. You have to have a parent that has to have the time, and maybe both parents have to work. This issue, then parents don't have a choice as to what school they're going to send them to get the kids in the culture that they want their children's into, to go to. So you have one parent saying, I don't want my kid to be disciplined at all. Okay, there should be a school that's established that says, children will not be disciplined at this school for these behaviors. Hitting a teacher. Okay, no discipline. All right, so the parent could have a choice to take him to that school. But most parents are going to say, I want discipline of my child. I want my child to behave, so I want my child to go to a school that is that way, that will do that, that will help in that process, and I will support that school. Okay, but when you have to mix parents with different philosophies and different standards and different beliefs, and one parent has to accept the belief of the other parent, that doesn't work. And you're going to have chaos. And that's why it's so important that a parent has a choice in the upbringing of their children and that they have options as to where they can send them to school. And that's why I'm in favor of a voucher system. Or the money goes with the child, okay, to what school. And the parents have that choice as to how to raise them. Okay, otherwise, that's why we're in this conflict here with the public schools. So his or her culture, well, what if there's the other child has a different culture? And that child's being offended left and right. Okay, so here's the reason why his question, this teacher's question will never be answered, because the school can't differentiate between behaviors that are acceptable and not acceptable. They can't differentiate on that. And that is why there is the gender equity policy at the St. Paul schools now. Okay, you got that? The school can't say what is right or what is wrong. So if that child comes and says, if the parent says, my child at the age of 2 self-identified as a boy and they're really a girl, they need to go in that boy's bathroom and use that, the school board can't say, boy, based on biology, that girl that thinks they're a boy is really a girl, so they need to go to the girls' restroom. They can't say that because they have no moral standards because of their philosophy. What is an acceptable behavior? They cannot make the decision. So everything goes. And that's the same thing that's happening as to why they won't discipline a kid who assaults a teacher. And believe me, there are plenty of assaults going on. And actually, I talked to one medical doctor. It's kind of not tied into the schools somewhat, but the crime rate and what's going on in the hospitals, in the emergency rooms, and the gunshots, he says, are 10 times more than what the paper's reporting. He's saying it is so bad out there that they don't report everything, and they can't because it will give a misperception of what's taking place. That's just how bad it is in St. Paul. But it's a cultural reflection, since there is no acceptable or unacceptable behavior. Okay, the only unacceptable behavior, though, because, you know, it's like a person says there's no absolutes. Well, you just created an absolute, so therefore there are absolutes. Okay, so one of the absolutes, you know. So there are absolutes, okay? This is the same thing. When they go and say there's no unacceptable behavior, there is one unacceptable behavior, and that's believing that there is an unacceptable behavior. So this teacher speaking out against the policies and against the children not being disciplined and the bad behavior of the children, he's the one with the unacceptable behavior. Okay, and so therefore he has to go. And so it's the sin of calling out the school board for their policies and practices that they have established. Just unbelievable. That's why he'll never get an answer to that question. And you as a parent, Good luck. So I'm going to add another issue. We think this is just in the schools. OSHA, this came out in the Washington Post yesterday. OSHA urges transgender bathroom access policies. So the federal government is strongly urging employers to give transgender employees access to bathrooms that correspond to their gender identity, making a new policy front in this fast-moving campaign of transgender equality. It is essential for employees to be able to work in a manner consistent with how they live the rest of their daily lives based on their gender identity, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration wrote in its four-page guide to restroom access for transgender workers posted last week in the policy's website. People, this is the brown shirts. This is Nazism. We're going to tell you, we're going to force this behavior down your throat. Whether you like it or not, you don't have your freedom of religion. These people are forcing your way, forcing their way into your lives, whether you like it or not. And you just won't have a say. You know, no matter what, and here's why you can't send your kids to the St. Paul Public Schools. Because they cannot teach biology. They cannot teach science. They cannot teach anything, engineering. They can't teach these things because if they did teach them, they would have to teach the kids that, you know, if you're born a boy, every aspect down to your DNA says you're a boy, okay? You cannot change that by a surgery. Bruce Jenner, I mean, the guy is as messed up. He's got a mental problem. It's a mental disease. And you talk to a lot of transgender people who have had the surgeries, made the switch, and live to regret it. Because you know what? It didn't solve the problems, the deep down problems. And Bruce Jenner admit he's got anger problems. He's so mad at somebody from his youth that's affected his life severely. But he didn't call the person out. He didn't say what it is. His response is, I'm so mad at this person, I'm a woman. Okay? He's still a man. Everything about him is a man. Even though he had surgery and's taken the hormones and looks more like a woman, every single cell in his body says he's a man. His just brain, and he's self-deceived into thinking he's a woman. And I or many other people are trying to be forced to say, you have to accept this. And you know what? I'm not going to do it. And now OSHA's coming out and saying, boy, the workplace, now you gotta do this for the mental health. These people's mental health is not doing good. And the OSHA policy will not help them in that. Okay. So, that's why you don't send your kids to St. Paul schools, because they won't learn biology. They won't learn engineering. They won't learn the sciences, because the sciences, the engineering, the biology all say, and it's irrefutable, there's no gay gene, you can't change your genetics, it's not going to happen, and your kids aren't going to learn anything. Some down the road, if they want to get a job in engineering or the sciences, they're going to have to come to the conclusion, wow, this isn't as what they're saying it is. Okay, it's just a whole big speech, a whole big spill, a whole big propaganda machine for a whole other purpose. And that whole other purpose is to take away your liberties, take away your freedoms. Okay, and thus we establish, so people know what are acceptable or unacceptable behavior, to protect the liberties. The purpose of education, according to the Minnesota Constitution, is to teach the Republican form of government so that it is preserved. That's the statement on education in Minnesota. Teach the Republican form. Establish an education system so that the Republican form of government may be preserved. And yet, what they're doing right now is taking it away. So what is acceptable and unacceptable behavior? We put that into our Constitution. And in our Constitution, we tell judges, you must live in the district, in the judicial district, where must live in that judicial district that you are elected in. You got to be a resident of that area. And we put it in there where, that way to establish boundaries. So you don't have people living outside your district telling the people how to live inside the district. And so you have also a form of accountability to the people versus an appointment system. Well, this is what happened with Judge Alan Pendleton. And he's a man that ran, tried to get appointed to the Minnesota Court of Appeals in the Plenty administration. I wrote the Plenty Court and gave him about three reasons why he shouldn't be appointed to the appellate court. And one of those was his judicial behavior and how he treated people in the courtroom. And this guy, he's got a lot of writing. He's got a lot of education behind him, and he knows stuff. But if you've seen him in that courtroom, he's a very arrogant man. And now it can change from day to day, but, you know, he's there to protect the government. And he said that in one hearing that I was watching. My people are good people. They're not going to make a bad decision. In the meantime, they're making a bad decision. And he finally realized it. But did he do anything about it? No, the damage and the harm was already done. So Judge Pendleton was appointed a judge. It's just funny how they do these findings of facts on Judge Pendleton. One, he's accused of not living in the district, which is a violation of the Constitution. You vacate your office. It's vacated. But now our courts have changed the definition of what vacate means. Or not recognize it. Who knows what they're doing, but they kind of change it in whatever situation they see fit, in my opinion. But a vacated office means you immediately are out of office. Okay? You don't sign your oath of office, you vacated your office, you're done. But they won't uphold that, as we've seen in cases before. But here Judge Pendleton moved out of the district, tried to hide it, and hid it for many years, and the Board on Judicial Standards just hemmed and hawed and didn't do anything about it. Finally, they're doing something about it. But it was just interesting on the findings of fact here. Judge Pendleton was appointed as a district court judge for Minnesota's 10th Judicial District in September of 1999. And then it says he was and reelected in 2002. Well, if you're appointed, you're not elected. Okay, so he says he was reelected in the proper wording would be he was elected in 2002 because of the appointment and then reelected in 2008 and 2014. So his current term expires in 2012. And if the Board on Judicial Standards knew all the stuff was going on with Pendleton, why wasn't it out in the press so that the people could know to make a decision on whether to have this guy as a judge? And why didn't anybody run against him, knowing the problems that he was having? And that's just because of the culture of the judiciary, where they don't want you to run against a sitting judge. And they don't want free and open elections, so they put pressure on you not to run against a judge. Or if you do run as a judge, you get penalized, which gets into the Michelle McDonald case. There's no way she's going to win a case. I'd be very surprised if she wins any cases before the appellate court or the Minnesota Supreme Court. Matter of fact, they're doing such strange things as not even giving her oral arguments. They're saying, no, we're not going to have your attorneys in here arguing your case. We're just going to meet as three judges based on what you wrote and made a decision. Why? Because it could be filmed. People could see it. You know, I mean, they know I'll be there filming. They know that because I'm already down there filming these things. Okay, and the appellate court doesn't get filmed unless you go down there and film it yourself. Supreme Court gets filmed, you can see all their archives. So this is this punishment that goes on if you run against a sitting judge. So it just kind of went through his track record here. In 10th Judicial District, anybody needs to know, that's Anoka County, Chisago, Isanti, Kennebec, Pine, Sherburne, Washington, and Wright counties. And Judge Pendleton practiced more out of Sherburne County, is where I always saw him in the court. But the people in Washington County, 30 miles away, you know, were voting for him or against him. As a judge in that county, which I think is a problem because the people in Washington County don't know anything about what's happening in Sherburne County. That news doesn't get down to Washington County, so they don't know. So I personally think these judges should be elected by the county that they serve in or will serve in. But it was interesting, which comes to the second problem with the Board on Judicial Standards, is that if you're a judge and the Board on Judicial Standards is the place to go to ask questions if you think there might be conflict, do you think certain situations may arise and you want to work them out ahead of time. But the problem is that's the Board on Judicial Standards and the people you communicate with are the same people that are going to come after you. Okay, so we as a citizen, we go out there and say, police officer, talk to my attorney. You know, I would never talk to a police officer, folks, not without an attorney present. That's your right. And actually, if you're going to protect yourself and protect yourself properly, don't talk. And I see over and over again people get in trouble for saying things that they say incorrectly. And then that gets held against them. And it's a big, bad problem. And so just don't talk to the police. Just say, you know, call my attorney. And more than likely, they're just going to let you go. You know, they just realize, okay, that's what it is. They have to have evidence to arrest you. They have to have it on their own. Okay. The whole issue here, was Pendleton in or out of the district? And during this time, his wife, Sarah, his first wife, we had a number of conversations because she found out I was dealing with some of the judicial issues. And she was telling me the story as it was laid out here, only she was saying that he was not living in the county, that he was saying that he was living in the county and living down with his girlfriend in Minnetonka on the weekends, but she was saying no, he was going down was down there all day. But you have to prove things. Rightly so, you have to prove things. So, I mean, I was telling her, look, you're gonna have to document it, you're gonna have to have proof, you're gonna have to have, you know, There, you can do some things on hearsay, but it's got to be stronger than just what you say if you really want to make this true. And if you really want it to be true or people understand it as true. And so, in my opinion, Judge Pendleton should have been gone a lot earlier for just his other courtroom antics that he plays. You think a court case is over, you know, everybody else is out in the hallway, then he calls people back in to do his dirty work, you know. And it's just, and so nobody gets to see what he's done. So during his divorce that he was going through, he did move, in my understanding, he did move out of the district. But they couldn't prove all of that. But what was interesting, while the divorce proceedings, they say here, were pending, Judge Pendleton rekindled a relationship with an old friend, Kimberly, who became his second wife in September of 2007. but the divorce started in April 2005. The facts that I've heard are different than that. Okay, and this Kimberly, I understand, is also an attorney, and let's say it's not out in the press, so I'm just not going to say other than that. You know, I was told he was not living there. Yeah. So during this process, Judge Pendleton, knowing the law, he's well-schooled, whether he follows, it's a whole nother issue. He contacted the Board on Judicial Standards, and he talked to David Paul, who was the Executive Secretary for the Board on Judicial Standards, and told him about things that were going on. But because, you know, Judge Pendleton resided over divorces, family law cases, he was a destructive person. I don't think he was fair in what he did, and I think he destroyed a lot of lives in this process. Well, he got hit hard, too, financially. Judges make good money, you know, but he ended up having to, according to the report here, his home in Albertville went into foreclosure in 2008. And let's see. So Judge Pendleton was staying with, from February 2008 till September, Judge Pendleton was staying with his second wife at her home in the city of Hopkins in Hennepin County, outside the 10th Judicial District. Now, it's real close to Minnetonka, and so it could be a Minnetonka post office box. So he said that he was temporarily staying in Hopkins for 6 or 7 months while I tried to resolve what I was considered to be an extreme financial emergency I was going through. And a divorce will do that, especially a divorce with a lot of debt. And anyway, the other thing, due to his financial circumstances following the foreclosures and eviction, Judge Pendleton asked his second wife for financial assistance to secure a new residence within the 10th Judicial District. Judge Pendleton testified that his wife did not want to throw away her money, to throw her money away for rent, and that they were looking for property that would be a good investment. Well, you know, part of that, in my opinion, was it's me or your judgeship, okay? Why don't you stay with me or get rid of your judgeship, okay? Let's quit playing this game, do one or the other, move in with me. You're here anyway, so let's not just rent a place. Let's buy a place, okay? Which means he wasn't living there, okay? And so they were looking for property that would be a good investment. Judge Pendleton did not seek temporary housing within the 10th Judicial District during the 6 to 7 months that he stayed in Hopkins and testified that he could not afford to do so. He wasn't living in the district, okay? And it wasn't a temporary thing. Okay, but he did move into a home in September 2008 that he and his wife purchased. But it goes further into that. He ends up basically what the board is accusing him is lying, in that he did not stay even in 2013, beginning in November 2013, until he moved into apartment of August of 2014, almost a year. Judge Pendleton did not have a place to live in the 10th Judicial District. So there's a whole bunch of periods of time that he wasn't living in the district. And that's where the board came down on him hard and said, nah, you know, you lied to us. You didn't tell us about this. You put on your campaign report that you're living at a place that you weren't living. So they came up with the conclusions, the board on the ultimate issues. The board has proven by clear and convincing evidence that Judge Pendleton was not a resident of his judicial district during the time period of January 15th, 2014 through June 2nd of 2014. Beginning November 27, 2013, Judge Pendleton did not have a place to live in the 10th Judicial District. Although he initially made efforts to retain new housing, Judge Pendleton suspended his housing search completely between January 15th and June 2014. Judge Pendleton asserts that he intended to remain a resident of the 10th Judicial District during the time, but he has presented no evidence corroborating that intent. Rather, the evidence supports the inference that he intended to abandon his residency within the district while addressing his familial issues. Judge Pendleton voluntarily decided to live with his second wife in Minnetonka for an indefinite period of time until he and his first wife figured out where his son would go to school. Judge Pendleton's failure to disclose his living situation during this time period, particularly in light of his previous disclosures to both his colleagues and to David Paul, belies Judge Pendleton's assertions that he intended to remain a resident of the 10th Judicial District. The fact that Judge Pendleton subsequently renewed his intent to reside in the district does not persuade the panel that he remained a resident of the district throughout. The panel finds that Judge Pendleton intentionally disregarded his constitutional obligation to remain a resident of his judicial district during his continuance in office. Okay, so the board also has proven by clear and convincing evidence Judge Pendleton knowingly made a false statement in the May 22, 2014 affidavit of candidacy. Judge Pendleton concedes that he had not lived in the address he provided on the affidavit for more than 6 months. The panel finds Judge Pendleton's testimony that he lacked any intent to deceive incredible when viewed in the context of the whole record. And so by failing, and here's what they come up with the punishment here, or the conclusions, by failing to reside within the judicial district during the period of time, it violated Article 6, Section 4 of the Minnesota Constitution and the Code on Judicial Conduct Rules 1.1, 1.2, and 2.1 by knowingly making a false statement in May 22, 2014, affidavit of candidacy. Judge Pendleton violated Minnesota Judicial Code, the Conduct Rules 1.1, 1.2, and 4.1A, section, subsection 9, number 9. So the recommendation is that Judge Pendleton be censured for his violations of the Minnesota Constitution and the Code of Judicial Conduct, and the sentence should be Judge Pendleton be suspended without pay from his position as judge of the district court for a period of at least 6 months. Okay, and the panel was divided. They wanted to go between six and 16 months. I don't know why they didn't consider the Constitution that said, or the statutes that said he vacated his office and that the seat's empty and the governor could appoint. I don't know why they didn't do that. They should have done that. In this situation. So since they said he wasn't there, the governor should just go in there and appoint somebody and have him replaced. Because they ruled he vacated his office. Now, the next step for Pendleton here is he can accept this discipline or he can appeal it. It'd go to a three-judge panel and they will rule. And it can totally change the determination of of the board judicial standards, the panel that the board had. And if he doesn't take that recommendation by the three-judge panel, then it goes to the Minnesota Supreme Court, and they will make a final determining decision. But in that process, they need to come up with, did he vacate the office? And that should have been in this report. Why they did not deal with whether he vacated his office and therefore the office is open, an open seat. I don't know why. It's just baffling that they don't consider that part of the Constitution and they don't consider that part of the statutes in this. Because it is considered a vacancy when you move out of the district. So, you know, I would like an answer on that. I'll need to get one. I guess I got to go to a Supreme Court justice and find out the answer on that, because nobody else is talking about it. Hey, next week on the show, if you're very familiar with what's going on in St. Cloud with the Somali students who are being very disruptive in the public schools, demanding Sharia law, demanding their what they call their religious liberties. I'm having a guest on, A.J. Kern. She's been on before, but she's been writing articles up in St. Cloud that have been getting press across the state, and she's going to tell us what's going on and how this is going to affect our schools, our school children, and our policies down the road. And people, this is a big problem. This is a huge problem for our families and for our public schools and where we head as a nation, because the religion of Islam is so counter to our Constitution and to our way of life, and it will destroy us if it gets implemented. And they need to have the freedom to go and live where they can. If they want to exercise that, they need to exercise that, or they need to pass it as a law for the whole group. Again, what's acceptable behavior and what isn't? St. Paul Public Schools, there is none, except if you disagree with them. All right, remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week. We'll see you next week.